There was a little piece of wood, and that little piece of wood was tremendously upset because on this particular day, a man had that piece of wood in his hand, and he was using a knife, and he was whittling away at him, and it hurt. And it's like he was crying out to the man, "Stop! Don't do this! Don't you understand? What are you doing? You're poking a hole in me too! This hurts!" But the man kept whittling. And it was almost as if the man was saying to the piece of wood, "Little piece of wood, without these holes and without all this cutting, you'll remain a stick forever. But what I may doing, you may think that I'm destroying you. But instead, I'm changing you into a flute. And your sweet music will charm the souls of men and comfort many a sorrowing heart. My cutting you is the making of you, for only thus can you be a blessing to the world." Church, isn't that powerful? I think about what that means to us. Have you ever gone through a time of suffering and you're like, I have no idea why I'm going through this? In fact, if you talk to people about questions that we raise among the church family, when things happen, when bad things happen to good people, what's the question we ask? We ask, why? Why did this happen? We also will ask the question, where? Where was God when this happened? It's interesting because we ask deep intellectual questions. We ask deep theological questions at the times that bad things happen to good people. And there are scriptures that give us some tremendous insight in answering these deep, deep questions. And James is not that book. We have said all along what? James is the most practical book in the New Testament. And by that, we need to understand, James is talking about suffering. He'll talk about suffering through this book. In today's passage, he talks about suffering. But as James has had this habit of doing, he talks about suffering and he gives us practical measures in how to address suffering in our life. Isn't that great news? Isn't that great news, especially I think about, now here's the great thing, y'all, that this lesson, that today's lesson, was already prepared weeks ago. It was planned that this would be the topic on this day. And so here we are, and we're reminded that in a time of suffering, in a time of uneasiness, that we can turn to God's Word, we can turn to the book of James, and we can find practical advice on how to deal with the struggles of life. Listen to this. These are verses we've already covered. James 1, verse 2. "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kind, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." You know what tough times do for people? Tough times help make us complete. They help make us mature people. But they don't just make us mature people, because times of trial and suffering and difficulty can also help make us more compassionate people. That's the message we have in James chapter 2. Again, a passage that we've already studied. Verse 14. "What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily bread, and if one of you says, 'Go in peace, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." So we already have some great practical advice that when we deal with difficult times, we want those times to help make us complete. But we also want them to help make us more compassionate people. So here's the thing. In this world, we know that bad things happen to good people, right? Good people get sick. Good people experience heartache. But there's another reason that bad things happen to good people. And that's because bad people do bad things to good people. James talks about that. In fact, why do you think that he would bring up in James chapter 1, do you remember this? He's talking about the importance of pure religion is this, to take care of what two groups? Widows and orphans. Why in the world do you think that James would have to bring up that particular statement in his letter? Because people were overlooking orphans and widows. He's talking in chapter 2 about that, you know, the rich come in and here, give the rich the good seats. Then the poor, you send them into the back corner. Why would James have to talk about that? And it's because they were giving the rich the preferential seats and they were overlooking the needs, the concerns of the poor. There were people that were doing bad things to good people. And now when we start talking about this and we have this opportunity to look, and in James chapter 5, he puts it this way. He deals with it by calling them oppressors and the oppressed. And he's got a message for both. First of all, I want us to look, and we're just going to read this and just briefly mention it, then we'll move on, because I really want to focus on the second half of our text for today. I want us to look in James chapter 5, verse 1, the message that James has for the oppressors, those that are causing trouble. Now listen, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming to you. Your wealth has rotted, and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in these last days. Look, the wages that you failed to pay the workers who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty. You have lived on earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fattened yourselves in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the innocent one who was not opposing you. Man, James is strong here, isn't he? He's telling them, let me tell you something. He said, if you're rich, you better be prepared because your day is coming. You've had all of your time. You've killed the fattened calf. You've enjoyed these things and you've done it at the expense of others, and you'd better beware. What does he say? Your day is coming. That strong message. He's telling them, you need to be ready. Well, you've enjoyed life. You've yucked it up. You've had a great time at the expense of others. Your day is coming. But I want us to focus this morning on verses 7 through 12 that Jesse read to us, because I think these are powerful verses for us, especially today. Let's look at verse 7. James writes, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against one another, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, nor by heaven or by earth or by anything else. All you need to say is a simple yes or no. Otherwise, you will be condemned." So what's James' message for us? Be patient. Be patient. There, that's it. We can go home. Didn't quite leave me satisfied. How about y'all? But James knew that. And so James says, be patient. And then he tells us why. Actually, first of all, if you'll look, one thing that he does is he gives us three examples of patience. And these are good ones for us. Some of these hit a little close to home for us. He talks about, the first example of patience is a farmer. Because a farmer will plant seed in one season and not gather the harvest until another season. Again, I don't fully understand that, but I know a lot of you guys, man, you were wishing that the rain would slow down because you want to get that garden prepared. You want to get that big old, you want to get this prepared and you want to plant your seeds and you want to get started. But you're not planning with the idea of turning back the next day or the next week and gathering that harvest. You have to get started because you know this, to grow the crop takes time. And there are seasons, my friends, my brothers and sisters, that we need to understand that the heartache that we go through today, that there will be a season of suffering in order for there to be a season of rejoicing. There will be a season of difficulty in order for there to be a season of growth. And we have to understand that a great lesson from the farmer. But there's a second example that we're given, and it's the example of the prophet. Man, I think about all the examples of the prophets that we have in Scripture. Ezekiel. Man, Ezekiel stood up, 1 Kings chapter 18, he stood up against the prophets of Baal and the prophets of Asherah. Remember that, right? Ezekiel had them. He said, all right, now we'll build these two altars. And they built them just alike. And he said, now y'all start praying and see if your God will bring down fire and will take care of the sacrifice on this altar. And what happened? The prophets of Baal started praying. They started yelling. So then Ezekiel starts giving a hard time. Says, well, maybe you need to yell a little louder. Maybe your gods are deaf. Maybe they're asleep. They cut themselves and they went through all of this. And what happened? Nothing. Nothing. And so then Ezekiel prays. He says, God, let it be clear that you are the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that you are the God of heaven. And man, fire came down from heaven and it lit up that sacrifice. It licked up the water that Ezekiel had thrown around that thing, and it licked up and it burned up the rock. Everything about the sacrifice and the altar burned up. Great day, right? The next chapter, though, has Ezekiel in one of the darkest days and moments of his life. He was hurting because he kept saying, he said, I feel God, I feel like I'm the only one left. He had to go through a season of darkness in order to find completeness. Oh man, there are other prophets too. Jeremiah. And Jeremiah preached, Jeremiah wrote, and he did all of these great things, but people didn't listen to him. So much so that what is it that we call Jeremiah? The what? The weeping prophet. I think about other prophets throughout the Old Testament, the ones that they preached and they proclaimed, and nobody listened. How would you feel if you knew that we were living a Christian life and we're trying to do good, but nobody would listen? It'd be discouraging. You'd want to give up, wouldn't you? But the example we have of being patient and of trusting God is in the example of the prophets. And then, there's a third, and that's Job. Man, whenever we talk about suffering, we can't talk about suffering without talking about Job. Man, he went through the struggle of losing livestock, of property, of family, his own health, his dignity. He lost all of those things. And here's the deal. We are able to look and to read that story with a unique perspective. We know how and why that was coming about, but Job did not. He was patient. I don't know. I tell you the word that I like. The word that I like better is he persevered. He asked difficult questions and he got answers eventually. But he was faithful to that. He persevered in church. Those are important words for us. That we need to be like the farmer that understands that you plant in one season and you gather in another. We need to be like the prophet, that we proclaim the truth and we live the truth. When it's easy, when it's difficult, when people are listening and when people are not. And then we're like Job, that we persevere through those difficult times. Because what happened to Job? ultimately, he was blessed by God. So we remember those things. All right, so why can we be patient? I know it sounds good. It sounds preachy on Sunday morning of why we can be patient. But what does the Bible have to tell us? James gives us three reasons in this particular passage. First of all, one of the things he's going to tell us is that God's in control. God is in control. Look at what he says. I need you to have your Bibles open and looking at this with me. In verse 4, what does he say? The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord. What is it, James? God is listening to us. And God is in control. Just like James said earlier this morning in our time of prayer. In verse 7, he tells us that the Lord is coming. In verse 9, he tells us the judge is standing at the door. Here's the thing, church, and understand this from Scripture. And I know there are times that we struggle. We have times of uncertainty. But it's in those times of uncertainty and we're being tested that more than at any other time, we need to know that God is in control. Throughout all of our uncertainties, through all of our difficulties in life, we need to understand this. God is in control. There's a second lesson that we need to hear from this, and we need to hear that God rewards patience. James 5, verse 11 says that the Lord blesses those who have persevered. He blesses those who have persevered. I want to get to this third one because this one is really good for us. God is working. God is working. Again, the second part of James 5:11 says, you have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen I love the New American Standard puts it this way, you have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealing. You have seen the outcome of the Lord's things. What does that tell us? That God is working. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. God is working. One of our favorite verses, Romans 8, 28, tells us that, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Here's the thing, church. God is working. At times when it's most difficult, God is working. At times when it seems darkest, God is working. But we need to know this. We need to have faith and we need to have assurance that God is in control. He rewards those who are patient. And that God is working. Make no doubt about it, church. As we prayed today, and as heaven was silenced in listening to that prayer, as God was listening, God is working. And what we want to be is we want to be faithful saints. We want to be faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. We want to be faithful children of God who believe and anxiously expect that. So in the meantime, what do we do? Again, with our text open. First of all, verse 8 would tell us we need to stand firm. What does it mean to stand firm? We don't compromise. We don't back off of our faith and our belief in God. Man, we believe in God when it's easy. We believe in God when it's difficult. We believe in God in times of prosperity. We believe in God in times of difficulty. We will trust in God. We will not compromise. We will stand firm. Verse 9, what does it say? We don't need to grumble against one another. Oh, man, that's important, isn't it, church? We don't need to grumble against each other because it can be so easy in times of difficult because we're all kind of straining and we're all a little anxious and we start getting bitter with each other. And what James would tell us is don't do that. Don't do that. Don't grumble against one another. Oh, man, these are important. And then finally, in verse 12, he would say, this is interesting. We don't need to make oaths. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. And I wondered about that, and I thought, well, what's the big deal about that? How does that fit in here? And I don't know if this is the only application of that, but let me ask you this. How many of you have ever heard, you may have done this or you may have heard of this, how many of you have tried to bargain with God? God, if you will just get me through this. God, if you'll just do this, then I will. You know what James would tell us? Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't make some promise. Don't make some... Just have faith in God. Just have faith in God. Just trust Him. Trust Him and believe in Him. Be patient. So there are things we don't do, but there are a couple of things, or three things specifically, that we need to do. First of all, returning to verse 8, we need to anticipate the Lord's return. I remember hearing prayers offered over the years where we would say, "Come, Lord Jesus." Very biblical prayer, by the way. We don't tend to offer that prayer much anymore, do we? You know why we don't offer that prayer? I've got a theory. We don't want to offer the prayer of, "Lord Jesus, come quickly," for a couple of reasons. First of all, because we kind of like earth a little bit too much. Danny, what does the song say? "This world is not my home. I'm what? Just passing through." Do we believe the words of the song? Do we believe the words of the scripture? Are we ready to pray, church? "Lord, come quickly." We need to also understand this. We need to also understand the importance of appreciating God's character. What is it that scripture says that He is full of what? He's full of mercy. And He's full of compassion. When everything looks bad, we need to focus on the character of God. Church, understand this. God is faithful. In the most difficult of times, God is faithful. He's got a huge track record of that. He's proven Himself faithful. Do I need to remind us of this? That at the very worst times, while we were still sinners, Christ did what? Christ died for us. You see, God has proven Himself as faithful. He's proven Himself faithful in the most difficult of times, in a time that the world treated His Son the very worst, that He accepted that sacrifice of Jesus as appropriate and as acceptable so that we might have forgiveness of sins. People, if Jesus came and died on the cross for our sins, and God saw that, and God raised Him from the dead, if we can't understand that God loves us and that He's faithful to us, then I don't know that there's anything else we can say about God's character. But He's full of compassion, and He's full of mercy, and He's never left us. He's promised He will never leave us, and He will not leave us now. And so we hold on to that. And we hold on, we appreciate God's character. Then there's a final thing we need to do. We need to join together, and we need to be a people of prayer. Now, we'll unpack that more next week, but can we just give you a little preview of that now? That we need to be a people of prayer. And what does James say? He says, man, when things are good, what do we need to do? We need to sing. We need to give praise to God. But when we're sick, what do we need to do? We need to pray. When there's sin in our lives, what do we need to do? We need to confess that sin, and we need to do what? Pray for one another. You see, church, we need to understand this. In times of good and bad, when things are good, we give praise to God. When things are difficult, we turn to God. We always want to rely on Him. We put our faith in God. So, church, will we do this? Will we be patient and let God be God? We will trust Him. We will put our trust in Him. I thought it was appropriate for us this morning to end with that preview of next week, because we have been drawn, we have been driven to our knees as a people of prayer. And I think that is so appropriate. But it may be this morning that as you look at your life and your relationship with God, it may be that you need to come to Jesus in baptism, confessing the good name of the Lord and repenting of your sins, confessing Jesus as Lord and being baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. But it may be this morning that you just desire us to pray for something in your life right now, something that you'd like for us to help you through this particular season. And if that's the case, then we want church to be church where we can pray for one another and we can pray with one another. And so if we can help you in any way this morning, I want to give you the opportunity to respond, even as we stand and sing.